in the middle of a beautiful morning at a beautiful cafe with my now beautiful husband, I started to lose vision in my left eye. I thought that I was having a heart attack, and I ended up going in an ambulance to a hospital, and someone came in and asked me, "How are your stress levels?" And I was like, "Well, pretty good. I'm a yoga teacher. I work in mindfulness." And they just kept prying, like, "Well, what is your work-life balance?" And I can say this now, but I just remember thinking, like, that's not it. Like, let's do some more tests, because there's no way. But it was. It was a panic attack. And in a way, that was a silver lining, because it brings you into your truth.
Benji, what are we going to do later today?
One thing we're really discovering in neurobiology right now is that the mind and the body are incredibly tightly coupled. Our brains are not separate from our bodies. Oftentimes people think about wellness as the absence of illness, but what we're really finding is that the way in which we live, the way in which we feel, the way in which we relate to one another and to ourselves is instrumental not only in our behavior and our minds, but also in our physical and biological health. And really reclaiming that space for wellness in a new way that supports ourselves and others in flourishing, that's the true path. One sort of pitfall, which is easy to stumble into in today's world, is that the readable accessibility of relationships, of communications, of very superficial ways of interacting with one another can easily supersede and push away the deeper things that we can notice, these sorts of emotional glimmers. So we really want to shift from having emotions that are about what things look like and what we do to emotions that are about ideas and beliefs and identities that are transcending in service of something bigger. This can be done in myriad ways. For some people, things like yoga or embodied movement and breath movement are a pattern that can really lead to these kinds of well-being, in part because they leverage and manage the physiology of the body, the breath, the movement in the service of the kind of after effects or the downstream effects that this has on the brain and on the mind. Noticing glimmers in the world, finding those good things to follow and to learn from is potentially a really important way forward to well-being, to things like gratitude, where you're really aware of and narratizing your own experience in a way that makes you feel like you belong there. When people interpret situations that they witness in the world in a way where they transcend the current context, they engage in a kind of deeper meaning making. So what you're really doing when you notice a glimmer in the world is you're interpreting beyond just the obvious thing and thinking of the story that actually gives bigger meaning into the future and from the past. One of the most powerful findings from our neurobiological work with teenagers from low socioeconomic situations is that the kinds of crime and violence that they had seen was directly related to and predicted actually the future thinning of regions of their cortex in their brain that are involved in all manner of attention, self-processing, emotion, reactivity, physiological arousal. So that is really sad to realize. But one of the most powerful findings that we've had is that when young people told us of the deeper stories of why they think these things happen, of the human side of the crime they've witnessed, to try to understand the ways in which society has failed people or has set people up to need in ways that end up hurting others inadvertently, they engaged in what we call transcendent reasoning. And when kids talked about it that way, we literally saw a reversing, a kind of resilience effect in the brain physically over time, where the same brain systems that were being thinned were being thickened again by these patterns of thinking.
What I'm interested in is really finding the most simple of tools, the gift of just being present and not feeling like you're supposed to be somewhere that you're not. It's about taking those little moments in your current world, which could be a stressful world, And finding gratitude, finding the beauty, finding a breath. I'm still learning to notice everything. I'm still learning to pay attention. You know, having a great fall and months of panic attacks is one story I share, but I'm learning all the time. And I'm really grateful for community, truly, to help teach me that.
One of the things that we're really discovering in the developmental science is the amazing degree to which young people's own capacities of mind, their dispositions in the social world, those patterns of mind appear actually to instrumentally grow physically their brains over time in ways that are conducive to well-being and to self-liking. What the neuroscience is showing us is that we are not little video recorders just kind of moving through the world, recording what happens and reacting appropriately or not. We're actively bringing ourselves and our expectations and imposing those onto the world. So we notice things that we are sort of situated to notice, or that we are in some way ready to notice or expecting to notice. And what that really means is that our frames of reference are constructed by our own ways of being in the world, by the habits of mind that we bring, by the experiences that we've had as we have subjectively made stories out of them. You could call this a kind of perception box. Not that there's a filter between you and the world, but it's that you actively are expecting and looking for things in the world. And ask yourself to really unpack the assumptions and the habits that undergird those assumptions, and to think about, are those the ones that are going to allow me to see those glimmers, to see the beautiful things, and to navigate towards those and to support them? There are many tips and tricks and ways to build this into a pattern for yourself, and different people are going to do things differently, and that's all wonderful. Some people like to take a walk with a friend or their pet just in green space and kind of be empty for a while and just let your mind sort of run free. Turn your cell phone and your media off at night. Get good sleep. Have good sort of mental hygiene.
When I think about the practice of glimmers, it gives me hope because it means we don't have to look for something outside of ourselves or outside of what we already have in the room. And I sit here now feeling like I genuinely have a connection with millions of friends all around the world, and that they have my back, and that they feel that I have their back. And I think that the only reason I can even semi-confidently share that here today is that I know that I have shown up in a way that feels true to myself.
Wishing you a beautiful day. Thank you for sharing this practice with me. Namaste.